Good evening, friends. Today we have Dr. Arvind sir from the Department of Rheumatology. He'll be giving us a class on antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. I'll quickly hand over to sir. Sir, thank you for agreeing to come and give us this class and lecture. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thanks, sir. First of all, it's my honor and privilege to be given this opportunity to deliver a lecture to you guys on antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Without wasting much time, I'll share my slides. Yeah, is it seen now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I want to just give a practical approach to antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, a little more than what is being given in the textbooks and sometimes. Lot of information which might not be essential when it comes to a practice point of view. So the outline of my presentation will be, I'll be covering these many topics, ranging from epidemiology, clinical features, the urgent classification criteria, pathogenesis in brief, laboratory identification, seronegative APS, and its associated antibody topics under different subcategories of the disease. So APS is a very heterogeneous disease with varied presentation, and it has multiple clinical features. It has thrombotic manifestations, as we all know. It has obstetric manifestations, which is equally important. Then the non-thrombotic manifestations, which of course the rare variant, the catastrophic APS, and there is also this asymptomatic APL positivity without much clinical features. So this comprises the whole spectrum of APS. So we'll break it down one by one. The incidence figures of APS coming from the developed countries like the North Americas and Europe state that the incidence is 2 per 1 lakh population per year, and with a prevalence of 50 per 1 lakh population. So this is these are all data from developed countries. We don't have such data from our region. So the disease is so heterogeneous that the first presentation can be to multiple departments, and multiple specialists can encounter APS in their clinical practice. So it could be a dermatologist, OGCN, neurologist, emergency physician, internist, hematologist, vascular physicians, rheumatologists, then orthopedic surgeons, strange, right? Orthopedic surgeons also, pediatricians. So a whole lot of specialties can be involved. I mean, as the first presentation. So everybody needs to know a little bit about APS. So I'll start out by highlighting this important paper. This is the document when it comes to APS. It is like an encyclopedia of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. This is called as a Europhospholipid project. It's a cohort of 1,000 APS patients from 13 European participating nations. So there were 20 centers recruiting 50 patients consecutively over a 2-year period from 1999 to 2001, and paper was published in 2002. The impact of this is so huge that there is no study in APS which is published without a landmark paper in that sense. So the data from the clinical, this 1,000 patients of APS tell us that it is a female predominant disease, 82% are female.
Sir, sorry, sir. You're not audible, sir.
Hello, now?
Sir, we couldn't hear from 82%
now?
Were female predominant. Yes, sir, now we are audible.
Now am I audible?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So 82% were, it's a female predominant disease, 82% being female predominant. Then the mean age at presentation is 34 years plus or minus 13 years. Then usually the presentation is between 15 to 50 years. So anything less than 15 years is called childhood onset APS, and anything more than 50 years is called as old age onset APS. So less than 1% of patients have catastrophic APS. Okay, so 53% of the patients are a primary presentation of APS. That means they do not have any other connective tissue disease associated in them. Whereas other 47% of patients usually have a secondarily associated CTD underlying. So the most common CTD is the lupus in 36% of patients. Whereas other diseases can be lupus-like syndromes, what you call as UCTDs, primary Sjogren's, rheumatoid arthritis, scleroderma, vasculitis, dermatomyositis, all of these. So that in this cohort, there are the thrombotic manifestations, or the predominant manifestations. You can see here that 88% of these patients have thrombotic manifestations, 27 venous and arterial combined in 15% of patients. There is the microcirculation thrombosis, which is seen in up to 9% of patients. Only obstetric events or only fetal loss without any associated thrombotic events were seen in 12% of patients. So the predominant presentation is thrombotic. So how do you distinguish APS-related thrombosis from other entities? Usually the presentation is in young patients. It can be unprovoked presentation. It can be a provoked presentation. The thrombosis is usually in unusual locations, like the inferior vena cava laryngeus. It could be in upper limb deep veins. It could be in the adrenal glands, and they can be recurrent in nature. So whenever they are recurrent, they usually tend to recur in the same places. So that's how you distinguish. And whenever you encounter arterial thrombosis, this is the first one of the first things that you have to suspect. So coming to venous, the most common venous bed to be affected thrombosis is the deep veins of the lower limbs. Whereas other venous systems, inferior vena cava system, hepatic vena cava system, renal veins, cerebral venous sinuses, so, and the adrenal glands, especially the adrenal venous drainage, can also be involved. The arterial thrombosis, usually most common site is cerebral vessels. So they can present like TIA or they can present like stroke. Other vascular beds also is mesenteric ischemia by way of involvement of mesenteric vessels. Then limb arteries, when you can have gangrene and ulcers as an
sir.
I'm really sorry. I think my internet connection is a little unstable. It's getting
yes, sir.
Disconnected again and again. Okay. So moving on to the obstetric manifestations, which were seen in this Eurolupus, Europhospholipid project cohort, The obstetric manifestations were seen in 590 pregnant females. The most common was preeclampsia, which was seen in 9.5% of patients, eclampsia in 4.4% of patients, abruptio placentae in 2% of patients. Around 74% of them succeeded in having one or more live births. The fetal manifestations was in 580 pregnancies in this cohort, including the multiple pregnancies. So the most common manifestation was early fetal loss, which was happening less than 10 weeks, late fetal loss more than 10 weeks, that was seen in 17% of pregnancies. So live births were seen in 47.7% of pregnancies, so 50% rate. And prematurity was among these live births, prematurity was very common in 1/3 of these patients. So what predicts the obstetric manifestations? Bad obstetric outcome. Previous history of thrombosis in a patient. Triple APS positivity is one of the strong predictors for. And another important thing is that if they are also at a high risk for them and also on follow-up. So they need to be monitored even if they are a pure obstetric APS subset. So coming to the other set of manifestations, they're called as a non-thrombotic manifestations. This can happen in many, many organ systems. The most common, even though it has been put in this table in the last, that is hematological, they are the most common non-thrombotic manifestations. They should have been way up. So thrombocytopenia is the most common non-thrombotic manifestation. AIHA is very common. Some rare entities called as lupus anticoagulant hypoprothrombinemia syndrome, acquired hemophilia, all of these also been described. The other manifestations could be in the pulmonary bed, where they can cause pulmonary hypertension, DAH, ARDS-like presentations. Cardiac involvement, cardiac valvulopathy is very, very common. Mitral regurgitant lesions are commonly encountered. And you can also get mirantic endocarditis-like lesions. Then CNS is a very common organ system to be involved, where you can get chorea, epilepsy, migraines, transverse myelitis, pseudo-MS-like presentations. These are very well described. AVN at can be a presentation in APS. Skin is isolated skin involvement also can be there. Usually the point, whenever you find a patient with livid radicularis, the first thing you should look for in such patients is for the presence of APS. So this is what how a livid radicularis would look like. If, of course, in our setting, you would not be able to see such a well established pattern. This is a fishnet kind of a pattern on lower limb, seen on the lower limbs as well as on the upper limbs. In our population, it might not be so. Easily appreciated. The other one is the livedoid vascular, small punched out ulcers with small satellite lesions being present around. And there will be a background of livido reticularis, fine or livedoid racemosa kind of a pattern also seen. Renal hypertension and APS nephropathy can also occur. So I just want to describe the most common clinical non-thrombotic manifestation being the thrombocytopenia. In a urophospholipid cohort, it was seen in 30% of patients, being more common in the secondary variant of APS than in the primary variant. In other studies, it has been described in higher percentage of patients, even up to 53% of patients. So the causation of this is multifactorial. It can be because of increased platelet activation and destruction, so-called consumption platelet consumption thrombocytopenia, especially if there is a microangiopathy in the setting of CAPS, HELP, and TTP-like presentations. Or it could be because of immune-mediated glycoprotein, beta-2 glycoprotein-related antibodies can cause, or even other antibodies which are present in CTDs can also cause a platelet destruction. So there can also be a decreased platelet production if there is associated bone marrow necrosis. There's a variant of APS called as the bone marrow melt, in which can give rise to aplastic kind of presentation in APS. So it's a multifactorial causation. Usually they are mild, they do not cause bleeding. In up to 10% of patients, it can be severe and can be symptomatic whenever it is less than 50,000. Whenever the platelet count is less than 50,000, most of these patients will have a underlying antiplatelet glycoprotein antibodies rather than antiphospholipid being the culprit in causing the thrombocytopenia. Okay, now something interesting. In the thrombocytopenia in APS, it's actually a representation of platelet activation rather than anything else. And it can be a harbinger for thrombotic events. Thrombocytopenia, higher the risk of thrombosis. So yeah, you've got to be kidding me. Yes, so let us review what is the evidence in favor of that. In ITP patients who were APL carriers, it has been seen that in multiple studies, observational as well as prospective, in up to 26 to 40% of patients, they develop thrombosis in during the follow. It could be the time frame is different in different studies, but nonetheless, it's a very much significant association. Okay, so coming to catastrophic APS. This also goes by the name of Asherson's syndrome by the person who recognized it. And I just forgot to highlight what is APS also called as. APS is called as Hughes syndrome. The person who first described it, first Graham Hughes, he's also called as almost a father of APS. So Asherson syndrome is catastrophic APS. Fortunately for us, it's a rare presentation. But unfortunately, if it happens, it carries a very high mortality, 50% mortality rate. Often the patient lands up in ICU quickly. So there is thrombosis in multiple vascular beds, which could be kidneys, lungs, brain, skin, heart, along with an associated cytokine storm. It requires early identification and urgent introduction of therapy. We'll come to it later in the management section. The cause of such presentation is not known. Why only 1% of patients of APS should present like this? So multiple theories are proposed, but none are well accepted. So there is the strongest theory is the genetic predisposition. Certain mutations are described to be associated with this kind of presentation. And well-known triggers are are present in up to almost 3/4 of the patients can have triggers in the form of an infection, APS patient in the form of an infection, malignancy, withdrawal of oral anticoagulation, trauma, surgery. So such history can be seen in 3/4 of patients. Let me go through a registry of CAPS patients. This is called as the International CAPS Registry. This is also by the same set of investigators who have been instrumental in developing the Europhospholipid project. So as of 2014, there were 445 patients of CAPS which were enrolled in this particular registry. And and 60% of them were primary APS. We can just have a look at which are the organ manifestations which are seen in this registry. The most common was the kidney. So they presented with renal insufficiency with varying degrees of proteinuria, hematuria, hypertension, followed by pulmonary bed, which was seen in up to 60% of patients, ARDS presentations, acute pulmonary embolism presentations, DH like presentations. CNS is third most common organ bed to be involved with encephalopathy, stroke, seizure-like presentations. Cardiac system is also very commonly involved in up to 50% of patients. There can be heart failure, there can be MI, acute valvular lesions precipitating failure. And as I told you, skin is a very common presentation in CAPS. Livedo reticularis can be seen in 42% of patients. So there is a preliminary classification criteria for APS as described by Asherson et al. So this is not, again, this is just a classification criteria. This is not a diagnostic criteria. It should just serve as a framework for studies, and rather than you diagnosing such patients with the use of the criteria. However, a knowledge of these will definitely help you in identifying these presentations whenever they happen. So the four points which need to be considered under this criteria are evidence of involvement of three or more organ systems. In a span of less than a week, they should happen simultaneously or in quick succession. There should be confirmation of small vessel occlusion. As we all know, CAPS is basically called as microscopic APS. So there should be evidence of thrombosis in the capillaries and small vessels on pathology, histopathology. And there should be a presence of laboratory antibody being present. So a definite APS is when you have all the four criteria being present. There are varying combinations which can lead to a probable CAPS-like presentation. So the CAPS has multiple differentials. Whenever you encounter a situation of CAPS, you should also keep in mind that the similar presentations which can happen are TTP-like presentations, HELLP syndrome, sepsis, DIC, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, renal scleroderma renal crisis. All of these can very much mimic CAPS. And how to identify CAPS? It can be one of the hyperferritinemic syndromes. There can be very severe thrombocytopenia. There can be schistocytes being present on fragmented RBCs, being present on peripheral smear. There can be very high LDH values and elevated creatinine and very high ferritin. So it can be one of the presentations of hyperferritinemic syndromes. So other hyperferritinemic syndromes are sepsis, TTP, and as well as adult onset Still's disease. So you should be aware of all such presentations. Okay, so quickly rounding up the pathogenesis of APS, we have to address two topics, that is both thrombotic and obstetric. So the main putative antigen in antiphospholipid antibody syndrome is not a phospholipid. So that is the misnomer here. So by true sense, APS is a misnomer. So the main putative antigen is beta 2 glycoprotein 1. So this is not a phospholipid. This is mainly a phospholipid binding plasma protein. So there is a misnomer there. So we need this is the structure of beta 2 glycoprotein 1. So this has five domains: domain 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the domain 5 carries the putative the antibody binding site and phospholipid binding site, and this is the domain 1 is the antibody binding site. So this leads to activation, binding of phospholipid leads to activation here. So what is the physiological role of beta 2 glycoprotein 1? It interacts with the cell surface receptors of multiple cells like endothelial cells, monocytes, platelets, trophoblasts, residual cells. And it has a physiological function of being a mild natural anticoagulant. And it protects the cell from death induced by endothelial stress. However, the clear role has not been identified. So it is known to exist in two states. So it can exist in a circular form where this is enclosed, where the binding site in domain one is not exposed. This is a closed conformation, and this is called as a sushi conformation or the open conformation, where upon binding to phospholipid or to LPS, the beta 2 molecule opens up and exposing the antibody binding site, which is the domain one, and therein come and bind your anti beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies and cause further cascade of events. So you must all be familiar with the two hit hypothesis of APS. The first hit being the presence of antiphospholipid antibodies and a state of activation of immune cells and endothelium, which is readily it shifts the balance of balance in towards a procoagulant phenotype rather than a anticoagulant phenotype which exists in physiology. So the second set of events that is called as the second hit is as a consequence of these immunological events, what is just waiting to happen is the complement activation and the actual thrombosis. So let us have a clear look at the events here. So as I told you, the antibodies are being present, are being secreted by the B cells and the plasma cells here. These are the anti beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies. So their presence and their binding to the beta 2 glycoprotein 1 molecule on the endothelium is the first hit. So what that causes is it can happen simultaneously. This on the endothelium as well as binding on the platelets can happen simultaneously. So usually to bind to the beta 2 glycoprotein 1 molecule, these have to exist in dimer forms. These antibodies have to exist in dimer forms. That is helped by the platelets. So platelet activation is a very essential role in the initial pathogenesis of APS. So what happens is the anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibody comes and binds to the APOER2 receptor on the platelets, and it can also bind to the facilitates the further dimerization of this antibodies along with the platelet factor 4, which assists them in this process, and it can lead on to several downstream activation pathways within the platelet itself, where you can have further production of platelet factor 4, thromboxin B2, and activation of P38 MAP kinase pathways, which can upregulate the NF kappa beta signaling. And also so platelet activation followed by endothelial activation is the sequence of events. So at the level of endothelial activation, P38 MAP kinase signaling, the events that happen are upregulation of a tissue factor, upregulation of ligand molecules like ICAM, VCAM1, E-selectin, and also secretion of pro-inflammatory cytokines like IL-1, IL-6, IL-8, TNF-alpha. So all these events, along with the such events cause disruption of annexin 5 shield. Annexin 5 shield is basically, it is an anticoagulant shield which exists in physiology. However, this is disrupted by all these mechanisms. So there's a disruption of annexin 5 protective shield. So all these set a perfect milieu for the next set of events which lead on to thrombosis. So this usually happens whenever there is an infection, there is inflammation like suppose SLE becomes reactive, certain medications, dehydration, all of these can set in. And the first event that takes place is the activation of complements. So C5, production of C5A, and C5A goes and binds to the C5A receptor on neutrophils and also on the monocytes. So there can be production of reactive oxygen species and upregulation of tissue factor on neutrophils. Also, monocytes can also give rise, there can be MAP kinase pathway, upregulation of MAP kinase, NF kappa beta signaling in monocytes, which can give rise to upregulation of tissue factor and upregulation of the C5A agonism along with the receptor. So all these events give rise to thrombosis. And also side by side, the persistent endothelial, persistent state of endothelial activation can upregulate the PI3K AKT pathway, with the mTOR pathway being activated, and there can be vascular stenosis. And that is also, it also can cause accelerated atherogenesis in APS patients. So this is a brief roundup of the thrombotic events. What happens in obstetric APS? The mechanisms which are thought to be involved in the causation are the placental tissue thrombosis, acute inflammation within the tissue, placental tissue, inhibition of syncytial trophoblast differentiation, induction of inflammatory phenotype of the decidual cells, and a complement activation. So these are the mechanisms which are described. So on one side, you can on this side you can have APL, which can induce placental thrombosis and cause activation of monocytes, platelet, endothelial cells, and disruption of annexin 5 anticoagulant shield. Other set of events are beta 2 glycoprotein antibodies can react with the trophoblasts and inhibit their proliferation differentiation and also cause apoptosis. So syncytiation of the trophoblast layer is inhibited. Then it can also react with the decidual cells and cause inflammatory phenotype in them. So all of these have been identified. So we'll go through the classification criteria now. I will not highlight classification criteria much. You can always read them in from the literature. So the original classification criteria was devised in Sapporo city of Japan. It was published in 1999, and it was further revised in 2004 and published in 2006 as a consensus statement in Australia, Sydney. So this is what we use in most studies now, this 2006 revised criteria. It has two arms, the clinical arm and the pregnancy, the clinical arm, which comprises of thrombotic arm and the pregnancy morbidity arm. So the venous or small vessel thrombosis in any tissue or organ. Pregnancy morbidity is categorized into three definitions here. More than or equal to one unexplained death of a morphologically normal fetus, more than 10 weeks of gestation, or more than or equal to one premature birth of morphologically normal unit at less than 30 eclampsia or placental insufficiency, more than or equal to three unexplained consecutive spontaneous abortions, less than 10 weeks of gestation with maternal anatomical hormonal abnormalities being ruled out, and chromosomal abnormalities on paternal and maternal sides also being excluded. So the lab criteria is three antibodies which need to be present on more than once, 12 weeks apart. So the three antibodies are the beta 2 glycoprotein antibodies, which are in present in high titer or medium or high titer, that is more than 99% lupus anticoagulant, I will come to that. Anticardiolipin antibody, the IgG or the IgM phenotype, again present in more than 99% on standardized ELISA. So one clinical criteria and one laboratory criteria is mandatory to classify as APS. So it's all well and good up to that, but the problem starts when people start to equate this with diagnostic criteria. So what happens if you use this classification criteria as a diagnosis or under diagnosis? So this criteria does not have consideration for differential diagnosis. So it is just apply the criteria and fulfill it. So there is no consideration of differential diagnosis. So, say, for example, there is a patient of COVID associated with APS-like state in ICU or any other infections with antibody positivity. So this can, if you apply this criteria, it can overdiagnose them as APS. Whereas under diagnosis, I'll give you an instance of lupus anticoagulant hypoprothrombinemia syndrome. This is a syndrome which is actually technically APS because it happens in association with lupus anticoagulant, but it does not cause clotting. It can cause clotting. However, it most of the times presents with bleeding. So often these patients do not get diagnosed if you apply the criteria. Okay, what happens to some patients who have, let us take an instance of a 36-year-old lady. So you can see that she is more than 35. So what happens if she has had only two first trimester abortions, that is less than 10 weeks, two first trimester abortions, but she's triple positive for the antibodies. So if you apply this criteria, she does not fulfill it. So, but you would not deny her treatment, right? So, and also if you apply this criteria, if the patient can only be APS if there is antibody positivity. If there is no antibody positivity, there is no scope for the disease to exist as per this classification criteria. However, we all know that there is an entity called as seronegative antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. So it exists. So we should not equate classification and diagnosis of a classification criteria is 100% sensitivity and 100% specificity for classification. So that is when it will serve as diagnostic criteria. So the sequence of events should be you diagnose and treat the patients and you classify and study them. So you can only classify patients if you have diagnosed them. So we should not equate them synonymously. Okay, coming to laboratory identification. Okay, so laboratory identification, the mainly the identification is of antiphospholipid antibodies, which also go by the name of APLs. So there are two types, the criteria antibodies and the non-criteria antibodies. So the criteria antibodies are LA, ACL, anti-beta-2-glycoprotein, both IgG and IgM isotypes. Non-criteria, there's an exhaustive list of non-criteria antibodies. The IGF isotypes of cardiolipin and beta-2-glycoprotein, as well as PSPT, domain 1 antibody, annexin 5 antibody. There's a whole lot of them. I'll come to it in some time. So let us focus on lupus anticoagulant testing for some time here. There are multiple guidelines which are there, which help us in standardizing the testing protocol for lupus anticoagulant. Lupus anticoagulant is a complex thing to understand. It is a people know it is like ANA. You know, it's like ANA is positive by immunofluorescence, but it will give you a pattern which, based on which, you have to do certain more ELISAs and find out whether what antibody is causing that ANA pattern. So LA is something like this. So it could be because of unknown and antibodies. It could be because of antibodies to prothrombin, or it could be because of antibodies directed towards beta-2-glycoprotein. So it's more. There's lack of clarity on that front. So these are the many guidelines which exist in standardizing the assays across the laboratories. The most commonly used one is the ISTH 2009 guideline. So I'll just highlight what are the principles behind this behind these updated guidelines. So what it states is that you need to look, identification of lupus anticoagulant involves screening, wherein you, this is the first step, screening, wherein you identify that the clotting test, so that is the APTT, are prolonged and in the presence of low amount of phospholipids. And then when you perform mixing studies, where you add mixing studies, it should not get corrected. As in factors, if you add factors, the mixing studies should not correct the prolongation of clotting times, which are seen in the screening tests. And the confirmed step will be wherein you add excess amount of phospholipid and you they are very much, the prolongation was very much phospholipid dependent, and on addition of phospholipid they are getting corrected. So this is the sequence of events which happen in a LA testing. So screen, mix, confirm. So there are usually two screen tests which are need to be used, which apply two different principles. The most common ones are used, which are used, are DRVVT, that is the dilute Russell Viper Venom test, and the other one is a APTT test. However, it needs to be sensitive to LA. What do you mean by sensitive to LA? That it, the reagent should contain low phospholipid content. So that serves as a good APTT screening reagent. So one, if one of these tests is positive, then you proceed to the mix. If none of these tests is positive, you do not proceed to the mix step. So if one of these is positive, you go to the mix, and if mix is showing that there is no mixing test, that is, if you mix the plasma of the patient with 1:1 with pooled normal plasma, it should not correct the prolongation of the clotting times, which are seen on the screening test. However, if mixing tests demonstrate that there is normalizing of the clotting times, it means that there is factor deficiency which is getting corrected. So then you don't usually proceed to confirm steps, but you still perform a confirmed test. Sometimes there can be existence of both a factor deficiency as well as the presence of a factor inhibitor. So okay, this is one YouTube link which I have, I'm just putting up. It is, this is the one we did in association with the immunohematology department, where we have put up the video on YouTube through Indian Rheumatology Association YouTube channel, where we are demonstrating the whole procedure of LA testing. Those interested can go to the YouTube IRA channel and access it there. Okay, coming to the problems of LA testing, where you cannot do LA testing. So patients on vitamin K antagonist already, if they have an INR of more than 3, it becomes a problematic situation. You cannot test these patients straight away for LA. However, if it is less than 1.5 INR, no problem. If there is INR is 1.3, 1.5 to 3, you can do mixing with normal pooled plasma, or alternatively use Icarin based time or type in snake venom time. Esther, sorry, I lost connection there.
Fine, sir. That's fine, sir. Yep. We didn't miss anything.
Am I keeping up some time? Yeah.
Fine,
50 minutes left. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I'll quickly go through.
Yes, sir.
Those patients on, can you see now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So those patients on heparin, unfractionated heparin, we can always use heparinase. What is the patient on before sending an LA test, so that the lab people know what are the problems and how they can how they can neutralize it before doing the assay. Otherwise, you'll get a report of false negative report. So low molecular weight heparin in prophylactic doses again is not a problem. it has less effect on DRVVT. Patients on DOACs, routinely they cannot be tested for LA. However, there are now some kits which are available, they are called as DOAC stop kits. The availability of these kits is not very easily available, so it becomes a problem. So ideally not to undergo LA testing on patients on DOACs. Okay, so other antibodies, that is the anti-cardiolipin and lysases, so there's nothing, not much of a problem in interpreting them. However, which is clinically important is a titer of more than 99th percentile for both these particular antibodies. So I'm just highlight what is the prevalence of these APLs in the Europhospholipid project cohort. So the 88% of these patients had anti-cardiolipin antibodies, followed by 54% of patients having lupus anticoagulant positivity. So at that time, when this study came out, there was no clinical use of beta-2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies. So there is no data on that in this table. So coming to quickly synopsize, what is the diagnostic performance of these criteria APLs? ACL is the most sensitive. So it can be present in up to 95% of patients, as high as that. It has got a good specificity, 90 to 95, matches up to LA in some studies. It has the best correlation with clinical event of arterial thrombosis. Anti-beta-2 glycoprotein 1 antibody, it is not as sensitive as the ACL. Whereas it is seen in up to 70% of patients, it has a very good specificity in excess of 90%. LA can be seen in up to 75% of patients. It has the highest specificity, almost up to 98%. And the best correlation is with pregnancy morbidity, even though it has very good correlation with thrombotic events also. Okay, so what if antibodies are negative? So what if antibodies are negative, but you still have a clinical suspicion because the clinical manifestations of the patient are such, so typical of an APS that you still entertain the diagnosis. So what is that? It's a diagnosis of exclusion. You have to rule out the presence of other prothrombotic manifestations like mutations, factor deficiencies, protein C, protein S deficiencies, homocysteinemia, PNH, the whole other things will have to be ruled out. So it's a controversial field. Many people believe that it exists. Some people don't believe it exists. But like how seronegative RA exists, there has to be an existence of seronegative APS also. So what helps us in identifying this seronegative APS entity? There are many antibodies called as the non-criteria antibodies. There's an exhaustive list of them. Almost 12, 15 of them are there. So I'll just highlight some important ones. This is called as anti-phosphatidyl ethanol amine antibodies, phosphatidyl inositol antibodies, anti-domain 1 antibodies of beta-2 glycoprotein 1, vimentin cardiolipin complex antibodies, anti-prothrombin phosphatidyl serine complex antibodies, annexin 5 antibodies, IgA isotypes of anti-cardiolipin and anti-beta-2 glycoprotein 1. Anti-NET antibodies are also described, anti-oxidized LDL antibodies. So I told you whole gamut of antibodies are there. And they also have clinical associations with APL manifestations. Again, I'm not going to highlight much. So you can, so the message is that I'll go to this particular study. So off late, when if we don't include patients with seronegative presentation in studies and we strictly restrict ourselves to Sapporo criteria, we will never be able to identify the seronegative APS entity. So the denominator, we don't know how many patients are seronegative. So the denominator is huge and unknown in this. We get a denominator, finite denominator, if you use the criteria. But if you use the stick to the criteria, we'll never be able to study these antibodies. So that is when these studies, newer studies, started to include the seronegative APS suspected group and found out that almost 50 to 60% of patients who were seronegative could be reclassified as antiphospholipid antibodies when they used these non-criteria antibodies. So this is the this is one important study which is highlighting that. So okay, so almost up to 63% of patients in the seronegative, I think that it has gone down there. Yeah. So you get the point. So 60% of patients who were initially seronegative could be reclassified as APS. Okay, the next important topic is risk stratification. Again, I'll quickly go through this because there is shortage of time. It is always important to risk stratify the patients because you know who is at high risk for thrombosis and pregnancy morbidity. So I'll quickly go to this slide, where is what you call as a high risk APL profile. So the presence of lupus anticoagulant on more than two occasions, 12 weeks apart, either it could be a single positivity or in association with either ACLA or beta 2 glycoprotein antibodies, or a triple positivity is called as a high risk profile. There are other scores called as GAP score, whereas this is very clinical. You can just risk stratify your patients based on the just knowing the APL profile of the patient. There's another clinical score called as the GAP score, where you add four antibody positivity, four antibody status, along with clinical risk factors of hyperlipidemia and arterial hypertension. And it's a linear sum. And in studies, it has been demonstrated that anything more than 16 on this score has a good prediction ability to identify future thrombotic events as well as recurrences. There's another score called as the APL score. It's a little complicated. It can also be used for risk stratification. And it has got a good ability to differentiate people with high risk of clotting. Whereas if a score of more than 30 on this score is there, you can see that those less than 30 and more than 30, how the Kaplan-Meier survival graph is just separating. So that was about risk stratification. You need to know it, because to manage your patients, that is the most important thing you need to do. So management. So we will stick to evidence-based management of APS. Most of what I'm presenting is from the EULAR recommendations, which was published in 2019. There is also the ACR recommendation, which is more or less echoing the same sentiment, but I don't want to put both of them together and confuse everybody. So the overarching principles of this is that it states risk stratify your patients, then screen them for cardiovascular risk factors and additional presence of CTDs. Patient education and counseling is very important. So as medicine, as physicians, you must all be aware of how you stratify your level of evidence. So I'm not going to highlight that. Coming to the recommendations per se, this is primary thromboprophylaxis in APL positive patients, but they do not have clinical manifestations of APL. So-called asymptomatic APL carriers. In those patients with high-risk APL profile, which I already highlighted, what is the high-risk profile? In those patients, it is recommended to use low-dose aspirin. In patients with SLE without APS, but a high-risk profile, APL profile, it is again recommended to start on low-dose aspirin. Non-pregnant women with past history of obstetric APS only, without any thrombotic manifestations, should be given low-dose aspirin. So that these are the recommendations. Coming to secondary thromboprophylaxis. Secondary thromboprophylaxis means, how do you prevent the further events after the patient has already had a thrombotic event. So coming to the venous entity, so the evidence is good in favor of this. Class, level of evidence is 1B bar, strength of recommendation is B. Vitamin K antagonist with a target INR of 2 to 3 is what is recommended. For unprovoked venous events, long-term use is recommended. For provoked events, sometimes if the patient does not have a very high-risk APL profile, you can also use like how we would do in the general population for short-term anticoagulation. But unprovoked, definitely long-term, as in lifelong. So in the arterial event, so secondary thromboprophylaxis in an arterial event, vitamin K antagonists are preferred over low-dose aspirin. The level of evidence is 2B. INR range of 2 to 3 or sometimes 3 to 4 based on how you the bleeding versus thrombotic risk of the patient is there. It the class of evidence being 1B. And there is also data on INR, low intensity INR of 2 to 3 or even lesser than that, 1.6 to 2.2, along with low dose aspirin, which could also be used. There is a strong against recommendation towards rivaroxaban. It should not be used in a patient with arterial thrombosis in APS. This is based on the trial data of TRAPS, which had to, the TRAPS study was evaluating rivaroxaban versus warfarin in arterial thrombotic patients. And it showed that the there were multiple arterial recurrences in patients on rivaroxaban. So the trial had to be terminated even before completion. So as of now, no rivaroxaban in arterial events. So what happens to, what is the recommendation on recurrent venous or arterial events? Despite adequate therapy, this is despite adequate therapy when you have sorted out the compliance is good and there is no other factor which is giving rise to a recurrent event. You could either go increase the INR target to a 3 to 4 or add low-dose aspirin to an existing oral anticoagulation or even switch to low molecular weight heparin in these patients. Okay, so how many patients have recurrence of arterial events? So you, here you can see that in one study, those patients who were only on low antiplatelets, they had the highest recurrence of events compared to those, highest recurrence of events compared to only anticoagulation, whereas the combined therapy with anticoagulation as well as antiplatelet has the least recurrence of thrombotic events. So highest was around 60% rate, up to low, least being maybe up to 10% rate of arterial events. So venous thrombotic events, if you stop, this is a broad study where venous thrombotic events in a broad sense were thrombotic events in a broad sense, patients were studied. And in them, some of them had antiphospholipid antibody being positive. So unprovoked events after stopping anticoagulation, those patients who did not have any antiphospholipid antibody, the recurrence rates were least in them, followed by any positive antiphospholipid antibody being there. And it was higher if the same antibody was present in multiple locations. And the recurrence rates were highest if another antibody or multiple antibodies were present. So I'll stop that. So when you encounter a recurrent venous or an arterial thrombotic event, what do you have to, what are the sequence of events you have to do? First of all, you need to ascertain that the drug compliance is good. The drug interactions are not there. The patient is adhering to dietary restrictions when it comes to green leafy vegetables, or they're not going overboard on home-based, you know, home remedies when it comes to clotting. So, and you have to document that there is a thrombosis and compare with previous imaging that it is a new one. Also look for what is the provoking event. And if events are happening multiple times, always look for other other factors being also present, other prothrombotic factors being present. And you need to address also the high risk cardiovascular risk factors also simultaneously, like hypertension, smoking, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, obesity. So all these things will have to be done. So this is 5 o'clock. Okay,
we can continue, sir.
Yeah,
it's already 3%.
I'll just quickly go through. Where do the international community in APS stand on recommending HCQ in APS situation? It is only recommended in refractory thrombotic APS or even refractory obstetric APS if they are not responding to the standard therapy, meaning they have recurrent events. So herein there is a study which is an open label randomized controlled trial where patients were randomized to standard care was along with standard care plus HCQ, and they saw that over time there was a lower incidence of recurrent thrombotic events in the HCQ added group compared to standard care only group, and it was protective. However, the sample size is very small, 25 patients each. So this is the highest evidence which is there on HCQ. Okay, coming to the special situation of anticoagulating a patient with low platelet. It's very important. This is not a rare entity. It very commonly happens in our clinical practice. So there is not much evidence in this field, but most of the evidence is extrapolated from what is there in patients on cancer chemotherapy studies. So when there is an acute venous thrombotic event and there is a low platelet, so you can go ahead and fully anticoagulate the patient if the platelet count is more than 50,000. However, if the platelet count is less than 50,000, you might have to bring up the platelet by way of transfusion or bring up the platelets with steroids or B-cell depletion therapy, IVIG therapy, so that you can reach a point where you can add anticoagulation in these patients. However, even the lower the risk of lower the platelet count, higher the thrombotic risk. So just you have to weigh in the bleeding and thrombotic risk and take a bold step there. Usually, low molecular weight is preferred in such a situation because it gives us the comfort of titrating the therapy rather than a vitamin K antagonist where the effect can go prolonged if at all we need to stop the therapy. Okay, so obstetric APS. I have some more slides here. Okay, obstetric APS. Shall I skip this, Esther?
Sir, we'll go through, sir, no problem.
Because I have maybe just 3-4 slides more. Is it okay or?
Perfectly fine, sir, no issues.
Yeah, okay. So in patients who have a high risk APL profile, but they don't have any history of thrombosis or pregnancy complications, they should be on low dose aspirin during pregnancy if it is their first pregnancy. So if already they have been diagnosed as obstetric APS, but there is no thrombotic event, however, there is with or without SLE, the patient is having more than 3 early fetal loss, less than 10 weeks gestation. So you need to use combination therapy of low dose aspirin plus heparin at prophylactic doses, that is 5000 BD of unfractionated heparin, or if it's a low molecular weight, once daily. If it is a history of delivery in the previous pregnancy of less than, late fetal loss or there is a presence of eclampsia or preeclampsia and prematurity leading to delivery less than 34 weeks of gestation, you have to treat the patient with low dose aspirin and heparin with prophylactic dose. Those with not satisfying the definition of criteria as per the definition of the Sapporo criteria, They need to be treated. You cannot, as I gave you the instance of one patient who is maybe 36-year-old patient. She just has one thrombotic event, and you know that the patient one early fetal loss, but you know that the patient has a high risk APL profile. Which way would you go? Would you want the patient to have another abortion and then wait to institute your heparin, or would you institute heparin straight away and prevent her from having an abortion? So that is the question there. That is where you have to go out of recommendation sometimes. So if already the patient failed on prophylactic dose heparin and low dose aspirin, you have to hike up the heparin to therapeutic doses. If still it is not working, then you are encountering a situation of refractory obstetric APS. You might have to consider adding HCQ. You might have to consider adding low dose prednisolone in the first trimester, IVIG, and now even anti-TNF is also being tried. So these are all off-label treatments. So we cannot. And if there is only obstetric APS along with no thrombotic APS, the heparin needs to be continued at least for 6 weeks following delivery. And if the patient is already a thrombotic APS patient, you can immediately switch on to warfarin following delivery. Okay, so a simple intervention of heparin plus low dose aspirin improves the pregnancy outcome to 70% in patients with OAPS. Whereas without heparin and low dose aspirin, the success rates are just some 20 to 30%. Catastrophic APS off late the mortality has come down to now almost 30% in the latest registries which are reporting. That is with the help of use of triple therapy, that is glucocorticoids, that is in the form of pulse glucocorticoids along with anticoagulation, or third component in the triple therapy is usage of total plasma exchange or plasmapheresis versus or IVIG, so that this triple therapy has helped us to bring down the mortality. If the patient is not responding to the triple therapy, you can also consider rituximab if time permits, or you might have to import eculizumab in such situations. But importing eculizumab can be prohibitively expensive, and it's a tedious process. So indications for steroids in APS, four situations where you would use them are AITP with bleeding manifestations if they're present, lupus anticoagulant hypoprothrombinemia syndrome along with bleeding, AIHA, especially if hemoglobin is less than 9, refractory OAPS. In first trimester, you can give up to 15 mg or 20 mg of prednisolone for the first 3 or 4 months. So this is one trial where rituximab has also been used for anticoagulation resistant manifestations of APS. So this was just a phase 2 open label trial where it was where it showed that it helped in non-criteria manifestations of APS like thrombocytopenia, valve disease, skin ulcers, nephropathy, cognitive dysfunctions improved. There was not much improvement in the thrombotic manifestations there. So last slide on use of DOACs in APS. It is strictly advised against to use in arterial events, as I've already highlighted. Conditional use of DOACs is permitted in venous thrombotic events. However, it should not be an upfront use. It should not be for your convenience or for the patient's convenience who cannot monitor INR, but only in situations where you have a labile INR, the patient is not achieving that with good adherence to vitamin K antagonist. In such situation only, you should consider using DOACs. Thank you. Sorry, I exceeded maybe 9 minutes.
10 minutes. That's okay, sir. Friends, yeah, if there are any doubts, you can ask sir now. We'll wait for a couple of minutes. Please unmute yourself and ask your doubts.
Is there anything?
So I have a doubt.
Yeah.
For a obstetric APS, where there were no previous thrombotic events for the mother, but she's lost baby. So she will receive low dose aspirin and heparin. So after pregnancy, what do we do? Do we anticoagulate her or we do not?
Yeah. No, we continue heparin for 6 weeks, only aspirin to be continued. Suppose that is only if you have the patient with a high risk APL profile. Any patient with a LA positive automatically qualifies as a high risk profile. LA persistent positivity, or even for that matter, double antibody positivity or triple antibody positivity.
Sure, sir. They go only on aspirin. No need to anticoagulate them unless they thrombose. Is that right?
Yes. Yes. Following the 6 weeks, only aspirin. Up to 6 weeks, heparin plus aspirin.
Sure, sir. Even otherwise, apart from pregnancy, when we have a SLE patient or some other patient who's got a high risk serological profile,
yes,
we do give low dose aspirin.
Yes, lifelong. SLE also, irrespective of whether they have had associated APS, even if they have a high risk APL profile, like I told you, LA,
yes,
or double antibody positivity, triple antibody positivity, evidence states, evidence, even though it is based mostly on observational studies, not interventional studies, what it shows is low dose aspirin helps in future thrombotic events coming.
Sure, sir. Friends, I'll
so that is the primary thromboprophylaxis, sir.
Yes, sir. I'll wait for a minute more. If there are any doubts, please unmute yourself and ask. Or you can also post on the chat box.
How do I see the chat box?
Dr. Arnab Biswas has asked for the link that you had provided for the serological testing to be posted in the chat box, sir.
Okay. Where is the chat box? I don't know. I'm not familiar with the Zoom platform. We use mostly that.
Yes, sir, I'll just ask Mr. Suresh to help. Sir, or the chat box enga irukku nu solunga. Avanga is
sir, you can stop sharing, sir.
Stop sharing, okay.
After the
okay, chat. Yeah. You can just go to YouTube, go to Indian Rheumatology Association channel there. In the channel you have the video. So this, anyway, I've shared the link here on the chat box.
Sure, sir. If there are no questions or doubts, shall we close the session? Sir, we are very grateful to you. I remember you as my registrar when I had my rheumatology posting. I really enjoyed the teaching and the time there. And even this lecture was very informative and very useful. Thank you very much for giving us your precious time, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
We look forward for many more sessions like this. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
All the best to everybody. So,
thank you, sir.
Yeah.